that try our souls and trouble our minds, but if we can just get to the King, if we can get to him in our worship, if we can get to him in our praise, we know that there we'll find rest and peace for our souls. Thank you, youth choir and young people. Y'all have been amazing today. Amen. Amen. We thank God for all of you. There is a word from the Lord, and I must admit that this was a difficult subject matter for me, because the Lord led me to a part of our history that most of the time we don't want to talk about. It's a painful part of history. And yet even in that, God still showed himself faithful. And some of you may be wondering, and why Pastor got t-shirt on today? First of all, because I wanted to. And secondly, because every now and then we need to remind ourselves of this message. Not to the exclusion of anybody else, and not to the defamation of anybody else. But we know and we understand that there we have a history where the general consensus of this nation has not validated us. And even now, there are some times, there are some people, there are some systems, there are some structures that yet still are in place that do not validate our humanity. And so we need to validate ourselves and make sure that folks know, yeah, our lives matter, and we're going to fight to make sure that we change the systems that do not validate us. And so, if you will, I would like to draw your attention to the New Testament book of the Acts of the Holy Spirit through the apostles. Again, we're going to deal with some difficult subject matter, but I promise you by the end of this, I'm going to give you something to shout about. Acts chapter 10. And I will be reading verses 34 through 39. Pray for me as I desire to speak what God has for us today. Acts. The Acts of the Holy Spirit through the Apostles, chapter number 10, and I will be reading verses 34 through 39. If you have it, please stand in reverence for the reading of God's Word, Acts chapter number 10, verses 34 through 39. Lift your Bibles in the air, your sword. And repeat after me, this is my Bible. I can have what it says I can have. I can do what it says I can do. I can be who it says I can be. Today I'm going to be taught from the Word of God. I boldly confess that my mind is alert, my heart is receptive, and I am about to receive the incorruptible, indestructible, ever-living seed of the Word of God. I'll never be the same. I'll never be the same. I'll never be the same. in Jesus' name. Acts chapter 10, verses 34 through 39. I will be reading from the New King James Version of the Bible, which reads like this. Then Peter opened his mouth and said, "In truth, I perceive that God shows no partiality. But in every nation, whoever fears him and works righteousness is accepted by him. The word which God sent to the children of Israel preached peace through Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That word you know, which was proclaimed throughout all Judea and began from Galilee after the baptism which John preached. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, who went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil. For God was with him. And we are witnesses of all things which he did, both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem, whom they killed by hanging on a tree." Somebody say a tree. I want to focus as the foundation for my subject. I want to focus on that last verse and that latter part, particularly of that last verse, where it says, "We are witnesses of all things which he did, both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem, whom they killed by hanging on a tree." And I want to preach from the subject, and again, I stole it, so y'all know your pastor is a thief. But I steal for a good cause. And so I want to preach. I chose the topic for this sermon from a great literary work that was authored and penned by the late Dr. James Cone, and I want to preach from the subject, the cross and the lynching tree. The cross and the lynching tree. Let us pray. Father, we bless your name. We thank you for this opportunity to proclaim your word. And now, God, use your weak and fractured servant to preach with power and with clarity and with conviction. Father, speak through me. Use my mind. Use my voice. Use my actions to make this word plain, even so a little child can understand. Now I pray, O God, that you would infuse me with your anointing and with your power to accomplish this task that is too great and too grave for me to accomplish on my own. Speak now, God, for your servant hears. In the mighty, matchless, magnanimous name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen. Amen. The cross and the lynching tree. Poet named Abel Maripool, or he is also known as Lewis Allen, penned these words and entitled this short poem, "Strange Fruit." And in this poem, he says these words: "Southern trees bear strange fruit, blood on the leaves and at the root, black bodies swinging in the southern breeze, strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees." As I said before, this was a painful subject for me to deal with and to address, as is quite a bit of the history of those who are the descendants of the black diaspora, the African diaspora in this country. The enslavement of black people in this country is a sin for which America remains unrepentant. Even 400 years after the first Africans arrived on these shores, the economy of the United States of America, both in the North and the South, was built on free labor of Africans stolen from their homeland and subjected to the brutal institution of forced labor, while companies, industries, banks, and individuals throughout this country profited and still profit from our enslavement. The horrors of slavery have been well documented and the effects have been enduring. However, there was an aspect of the subjugation of those of African descent that was unconceivably cruel and vile and immoral and inhumane, evil and heinous. And it mostly took place after slavery was abolished. What are you talking about, preacher? What could be more horrible than slavery? I'm glad you asked. I'm referring and speaking of the acts of lynching. This state-sanctioned domestic terrorism was utilized to remind black people of their subservient place in society by white racists after the Emancipation Proclamation, and it was utilized to ensure the dominance of white culture. Lynchings became social gatherings, which could attract up to 20,000 men, women, and children for the sole purpose of witnessing the mutilation, burning, and hanging of a black person whose only crime was being born with dark skin. Not only did lynchings themselves destroy lives, but the constant threat of being a victim of a lynch mob resulted in the members of the black community living in a perpetual state of terror and fear. In his book, The Cross and the Lynching Tree, Dr. Cone quotes a white Southerner that compared killing a black person to killing a chicken or a flea. That's how we were viewed by some of the white Southerners at that time. Thousands of black lives were brutalized and destroyed by public lynching. Yet many city, state, and government officials, including the presidents of the United States, proved incompetent in stopping these murders and bringing the culprits to justice. Amen. Surprisingly, many of these same souls that endured the looming specter of the lynching tree were able to look to another tree. And they were able to look to this tree and find hope, strength, power, and salvation. And the tree that I am referring to was that tree that stood at Calvary. That tree that upon which our Savior Jesus Christ was crucified. In the text upon which this sermon finds its foundation, we see God's inclusivity in extending his grace and his Holy Spirit to those who were marginalized and deemed unworthy. And those people were the Gentiles. Cornelius, a Gentile centurion, has a vision that results in Peter being invited to his home. And this is after Pentecost had already occurred. And as a result of Peter preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ to Cornelius and his family, God's response was the Holy Spirit being given to the Gentiles, much to the surprise of the Jewish Christians that accompanied Peter. Peter proclaims in this text, I truly understand that God shows no partiality. But in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. Regardless of race, creed, color, God shows the early church that everybody is acceptable to him. The ministry of Jesus Christ was characterized by his willingness to embrace those that others deemed unacceptable. Let me give you some proof here. From the time he proclaimed in the temple that the Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom to the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind and to set the oppressed free. To his life-changing conversation with the Samaritan woman that was ostracized from society because she had been forced to go from man to man to man, but when she met the real man, her life was changed, and she was the evangelist to the Samaritan people. To his command for us to care for the least of these, Jesus demonstrates an affinity for the marginalized, the outcast, those that society has thrown away. But I have to admit, my brothers and sisters, I still wrestled with the question for black people. I wrestled with the question for us that have a history of being terrorized by the image of a tree. What drew us to that tree in Calvary? And I want to share with you three reasons. And then I'm going to let you go home. First and foremost, I believe that we found a sense of solidarity with the one that hung on the tree. Let me prove my point here. The Bible says that we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just like we have been and like we continue to be, yet he did not sin. When the country rejected us, tries to devalue us, tries to dehumanize us and to destroy us, we have an Afro-Asiatic savior. Can I speak truth in here today? We have an Afro-Asiatic savior that not only understands our suffering, but will enter into our suffering with us. Jesus knows how it feels to be discredited, to be dismissed, to be devalued by friends, family, and foes. He knows how it feels to live with the possibility that at any time you can be executed, not for any crime committed or wrong done, but just being who you are. He knows. And he understands, Jesus understands how it feels to have your life taken away by state-sanctioned violence, sanctioned not only by the state, but by religious leaders. Jesus knows. And he understands. As a people, we relate to the story about Jesus Christ, because he too was despised and rejected by mankind. He was a man of suffering and familiar with pain. And we found solidarity with him because, like one whom people hide their faces from, he was despised and he was held in low esteem. That's why the saints of old used to sing, "Nobody knows the trouble I've seen. Nobody knows but Jesus. Nobody knows the trouble I've seen." But because they found solidarity with their Savior, they were able to end that verse with glory, hallelujah. They were able to praise God for a Savior that, despite of the trouble that they found themselves in, they knew they had a Savior that not only understood their plight, but had the power to deliver them out of it. My second point is this: we look to the cross because therein lies our hope. Even in the midst of our despair, the cross is the symbol that blatantly proclaimed to the world that no matter how dark the night, no matter how hopeless the situation seems to appear, our God is able to turn a situation around. And not just turn it around, but he is able to work it out for our good, no matter how horrible it may seem. The cross is a symbol to us that this too shall pass. God is going to move in the midst and in our situation, and he's going to give us victory over it. The late James Cone said it like this. He said, "The cross is a paradoxical religious symbol because it inverts the world's value system with the news that hope comes by way of defeat, that suffering and death do not have the last word, and that the last shall be first. And the first is going to be last. The cross is the monument which symbolizes the defeat of Satan's kingdom and the eternal victory of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The cross represented the fulfillment of the law of Moses. The cross shifted the paradigm from the restrictive requirements of the law and ushered us into the dispensation of God's grace." That's what we saw in the cross. Our ancestors endured the master's whip and the cruel, back-breaking labor of slavery because the cross gave them hope. Even when those who taught us the Bible tried to use it as a weapon to continue our subjugation, we saw something in the cross. And it gave us hope that soon we would be done from the troubles of the world. It was hope that enabled our ancestors to endure the Jim Crow era and government-sanctioned segregation. It was the hope of the finished work of Jesus Christ that caused Harriet Tubman to risk her life over and over again to return to the South repeatedly, despite the bounty that was placed on her life, to free as many slaves as she could. It was the hope that caused Dr. King to boldly proclaim, as he prophetically viewed the promised land of equality and justice, that we would make that promised land a reality, even though he knew that he wouldn't make it there with us. Yet he still proclaimed in his soul that we as a people will get to the promised land. It is hope that we hold dear as we look at the cross. The hope that this country can live up to the causes and the creeds that it has espoused verbally. It is the hope that this country will finally live up to what it has told us its people for so long. And it is hope that causes us to fight against anything that keeps us fractured. It is hope that causes us to continue to fight against racism. It is hope that causes us to continue to fight against sexism. It's hope that causes us to fight against xenophobia and anti-Semitism and Islamophobia and every other wicked evil spirit that fails to recognize the humanity in others. It is hope that causes us to fight against voter fraud and voter suppression. It's hope that causes us to fight against income inequality. It's hope that causes us to fight against mass incarceration and police brutality. It's hope that we see on the cross. And no matter how bleak our current climate gets, we cannot allow ourselves to fall into the sinkhole of despair. But we must maintain our hope. The day that we lose hope is the day that we die. But I declare in this house over these people, we shall not die, but we will live to declare the works of the Lord. We have come too far to lose hope and die now. My last point is this that I'm going to share with you, and then I'll be done. Lastly, the hope is a symbol of God's justice. We know that the gospel is the birth, the life, the death, the burial, the resurrection, and the second coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That's the gospel. The good news. Jesus is coming again. And when he returns, the Bible informs us that he will judge the living and the dead. God is a God of mercy. Yes, yes, he is. And his mercy is unlimitless, but he's also a God of judgment. Amen. And he will judge everyone that actively or passively participated in the subjugation of his people. God is going to judge. Whether it's Bull Connor or George Wallace or Strom Thurmond, God is going to judge them for their participation, as well as judge us for what we have fallen short on. It may seem to you now, particularly in this political climate, it may seem that evildoers don't pay for their crimes. That if you have enough money, if you have enough influence, that you can just get off performing heinous things with just a slap on the wrist. But the Bible tells us to fret not thyself because of evildoers, and neither be thou envious against the workers of iniquity, for they shall soon be cut off, cut down like the grass and wither like the green herb. The Bible also lets us know that we don't have to bring recompense for ourselves, but our God has declared that vengeance is mine. I will repay. God may not repay in a time that we feel that he should repay. Amen. But rest assured, my brother and my sister, everybody is going to have to stand before the judgment seat of God. And they are going to have to give an account. And so we look at the cross like those that came before us, because we believe that we find solidarity with Jesus Christ. He sees and he knows our suffering, and he relates to all of our pain. We look to the cross like those that came before us, because we know we can find hope there at Calvary's tree. A hope that will not disappoint us. And we look to the cross like those ancestors that came before us, because we know that we will find justice there. And when he comes, everybody is going to have to stand before God. Everybody is going to have to give an account, both the good and the bad, of what you did and what we did in this life. And so we look to the cross like those that came before us. And like them, we continue to find comfort as we sing the old hymns of the church. At the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burdens of my heart, they rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. We continue to look to the cross as the ancestors did before, and we continue to find comfort as we sing the songs of Zion. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name, on Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. We continue to look to the cross as our ancestors did before us, and we begin to sing songs that give us hope and give us peace, that give us comfort in the gospel message. I know this is more of song from the Kojic folk, but I got a little Kojic in me, and I used to hang at the Kojic church, and I heard them say this song: living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. But rising, he justified and freed me forever. And one day, my Jesus is coming back. And when he cracks the sky, when he comes with the sound of the trumpet, they rejoiced and declared that it's going to be a glorious, glorious day. We can look to the cross. The old rugged cross. I think we need another picture of the cross. Because nowadays, you know, we done prettied the cross up. We have nice gold crosses like this. Crosses with lights on them. And we wear crosses on our necks. They nice, and some folks done blinged out the cross. I have a friend that's just jewels all on the cross and hangs on his rearview mirror. And I saw it one day and I asked myself, when did the cross get glamorous? We need another view of the cross. Because when you really look at it, the cross, there was nothing glamorous about the cross. The cross was rough. The cross was heinous. The cross was painful. Wasn't any smooth wood on the cross. But they took a tree. Didn't smooth it out. Took our Savior. Hung him on it. The old church used to say they lifted him high, stretched him wide, nails in his hands, nails in his feet, pierced his side. Blood and water ran from his side. Scientists have done a study and written a paper on just what went on in Jesus' crucifixion. And they said that when they pierced him in the side, it punctured his lung. And so his lung filled with water and with blood. And as he hung on the cross, in order for him to breathe, he had to pull himself up on the nails, take a breath, and then lower himself down. And then pull himself up on the nails as it continued to rip his flesh, and then lower himself down. And he did all of that. He endured that pain after being whipped all night long, flesh ripped from his body. He endured all of that for you and I. Because of the sins that we committed and continue to commit. So that we could have hope. So that we could understand that we have a Savior that relates to our suffering. And to understand that even though it seems like those that have demonized us are getting away with it, we have a Savior who's going to meet justice out to those that have abused us. And so as you're standing and resting on your feet,